What is attrition? Attrition is the loss of study units, such as students or teachers, from a sample. It occurs when a study's analysis does not include a sample member who was randomly assigned as part of the study. Attrition is a key consideration for RCTs, but the WWC does not assess attrition for quasi-experimental designs. Within a study, attrition rates may vary across time periods, data sources, and even different outcomes. The example illustrated here shows a study sample at random assignment and follow-up. The boxes on the left illustrate the full sample of 48 randomly assigned individuals, 24 in the intervention group and 24 in the comparison group. By the time of the first follow-up, only a subset of those 48 individuals remain in the study. The boxes on the right show that the study observes outcome data for only 13 individuals in the intervention group and 14 in the comparison group at follow-up. What causes attrition? There are many reasons why a study may not include data for a sample member who went through random assignment at the beginning of a study. This slide presents a few causes of attrition, though it is certainly not an exhaustive list. For example, parents may not consent to their child's participation in the study. Students may move and transfer to a school that isn't participating in the study. Or students may be absent when the study collects data. Other causes of attrition include a student's refusal to participate, an inability to locate students who are enrolled in the study, students dropping out of the study, and inconsistent or missing data. Why does the WWC care about attrition? Bearing in mind that the attrition standard focuses on RCTs, recall the benefits of an RCT that we discussed in the group designs module, which is module 1. After a study conducts random assignment, the intervention and comparison groups should be similar. However, when attrition occurs, the groups can become dissimilar, which can lead to bias in the estimated effect or impact of the intervention. Bias is a systematic difference between the true impact of the intervention and the estimated impact, which can lead to incorrect conclusions about the effect of the intervention. Suppose an intervention actually has no effect on students' test scores, so the true impact is zero. However, it may appear that the intervention had a positive impact because of the students who remain in the groups after attrition. For example, imagine that the individuals shown in red in this illustration always score higher than all of the other individuals. There are equal numbers of red individuals in the intervention and comparison groups at random assignment, but at follow-up, the study experiences some attrition. Now, because there are more red individuals in the intervention group than in the comparison group, the intervention group, on average, has higher test scores at follow-up than the comparison group. As a result, the intervention may appear to have an impact when it did not because of the attrition. Attrition can result in a systematic bias if something other than the intervention is causing the difference between the groups in the study. The WWC focuses on two different types of attrition, overall and differential. Overall attrition is the percentage of randomly assigned units for which the researchers do not observe outcome data. You can think of overall attrition as the level of attrition for the whole sample. For example, the overall attrition rate would be 25% if 75% of all sample members remained in the study. But sometimes studies have more attrition in one group than in the other group. Differential attrition is the absolute value of the percentage point difference between attrition rates for the intervention group and the comparison group. You can think of differential attrition as the level of attrition for the intervention group minus the level of attrition for the comparison group. So for example, if 35% of the individuals in the intervention group dropped out of the study, along with 15% of the comparison group, the differential attrition rate would be 20 percentage points, which is 35 minus 15. For the WWC attrition standard, both overall and differential attrition are important. Next, let's take a closer look at how the WWC calculates overall and differential attrition and walk through an example. How does the WWC calculate overall attrition? The overall attrition rate is simply the number of units without observed data in the analysis divided by the number of units that the study randomly assigned. To calculate differential attrition, the WWC uses the same approach it uses to calculate overall attrition, but it does the calculation separately for the intervention group and the comparison group. Then, after calculating attrition for each group, find the difference between the attrition rates for the two groups. Take the absolute value of that difference to get the differential attrition rate. Let's walk through an example of calculating attrition. A research team randomly assigns 1,000 students to the intervention group and 1,100 to the comparison group. The team collects post-test data from 900 intervention students and 927 comparison students. Using this information, we'll calculate overall attrition, attrition for the intervention group, attrition for the comparison group, and differential attrition. Let's first visualize the numbers in the example. For the intervention group, we know that there are 1,000 students in the group, and the researchers collected post-test data for 900 of them. For the comparison group, we know that there are 1,100 students in the group, and the researchers collected post-test data for 927 of them. The total sample size is 2,100 students, 1,000 intervention group students, plus 1,100 comparison group students. The total number of students with observed post-test data is 1,827 students, 900 intervention group students, plus 927 comparison group students. We need two quantities to calculate overall attrition: the total size of the randomly assigned sample and the total number of sample members with observed data. We take the difference of these two totals to calculate the total number of students without observed post-test data. We started with 2,100 randomly assigned students. The researchers observed outcome data for 1,827 students. The difference is 273, meaning the researchers did not observe outcome data for 273 students. The loss of 273 students from the 2,100 randomly assigned students represents attrition. We divide 273 by 2,100 and get 13%. 13% is our overall attrition rate. The WWC takes a similar approach for differential attrition, but conducts the calculation for each group. For the intervention group, we started with 1,000 randomly assigned students. The researchers observed data for only 900 students, so they didn't observe data for 100 students out of 1,000. The attrition rate for the intervention group is 10%. For the comparison group, 173 of the 1,100 randomly assigned students lack observed data. This results in a 15.7% attrition rate for the comparison group. Then, take the absolute value of the difference between the two attrition rates. We get 5.7 percentage points as our differential attrition rate. We will discuss later in this module how to apply the WWC Attrition Standard to determine whether the amount of attrition in this study is large enough to affect the rating of the study. The purpose of the WWC Attrition Standard is to limit the amount of bias that could result from attrition in an RCT that receives the highest rating. The WWC Attrition Standard is based on a model of attrition bias. The attrition model drew on data from several large education studies and considers different combinations of overall and differential attrition, estimating how much bias is expected for each combination. The WWC chose 0.05 standard deviations as the threshold for an acceptable or tolerable level of bias. If the model suggests that the study's expected attrition bias is greater than or equal to 0.05 standard deviations in absolute value, the WWC defines that as high attrition. This is not a tolerable amount of bias. The chance that attrition, rather than the intervention alone, could be responsible for the measured difference in outcomes is too high. As a result, RCTs with high attrition must demonstrate equivalence between the intervention and comparison groups. The baseline equivalence module, which is module 3, discusses this requirement for high attrition RCTs in detail. If the model indicates expected bias of less than 0.05 standard deviations in absolute value, the WWC defines that as low attrition. That is, the study has a tolerable amount of bias. We can be reasonably confident that the estimated impact reflects the true impact of the intervention. RCTs with low attrition can receive the highest rating, meets WWC group design standards without reservations. We have a matching game to help you practice what you've learned. In this game, you will match a phrase in the left column with a phrase in the right column. The first term listed in the left column is attrition. Does it match to choice A, B, C, D, or E? Please feel free to pause the video at this point so that you can read through the answer choices first. The correct answer is C. When an analysis did not include an outcome from an individual randomly assigned in the study. The second term listed in the left column is overall attrition. What choice does it match to? The correct answer is A, the percentage of randomly assigned individuals who do not have outcome data. How about the third term, attrition bias? Does it match to choice B, D, or E? The correct answer is B, systematic error in an estimate due to loss of sample. Keep in mind that bias is not something that reviewers calculate. Reviewers calculate attrition rates, and those rates lead to different levels of expected bias, as indicated by the WWC attrition model. What phrase does the term differential attrition match to? The correct answer is E, the difference between intervention and comparison group attrition. That leaves the tolerable level of bias, which matches to an effect size of 0.05 standard deviations. That is, if the attrition rate leads to an expected bias of less than 0.05 standard deviations in absolute value, the WWC considers that a tolerable level of bias and thus low attrition. The WWC applies this standard to each time point of each outcome, so it is possible for a study to have high attrition for one outcome and low attrition for another. It's time for our first knowledge check. Which of the following is not a cause of attrition? A, researchers collected parent permission forms after random assignment. Some parents did not want their child to participate in the study. B, Thomas had permission from his parents to participate in the study, but he refused to complete the assessment. C, Anne took the pretest, participated in the intervention, then dropped out of the study. D, Juanita did not consent to the study before random assignment, so the authors did not collect outcome data from her. The correct answer is D. This scenario is not a cause of attrition. Juanita did not consent to the study before random assignment, so the authors did not collect outcome data from her. She never consented to participate, so the authors never randomly assigned her. Non-consent before randomization is not a cause of attrition, because attrition includes only individuals who went through random assignment. However, non-consent after randomization is a cause of attrition. Often, some parents do not want their child to participate in a research study, but non-consent after random assignment is considered attrition, so choice A is incorrect. For choice B, Thomas had permission from his parents to participate in the study, but he refused to complete the assessment. Non-participation is a cause of attrition, so choice B is incorrect. Finally, if a student drops out of the study before completing the post-test assessment, then the WWC considers that attrition. Choice C is incorrect. Knowledge check 2. Which of the following is not a cause of attrition? A. Ricky, Elena, and Sam were absent on the day of outcome data collection. B. Martin was not listed on the class roster that was used to randomly assign students, so he was not randomized to a condition. Because of this, the researchers did not collect outcome data from Martin. C. Researchers could not locate Jim, Juan, and Samina because they did not attempt to track and collect data from students who moved or dropped out of school. D. Researchers used school records to construct study outcomes, and the records were incomplete. The correct answer is B. Martin was not randomized to condition. A participant must be randomly assigned to be counted as attrition. When students are absent on the day of data collection, researchers cannot collect outcome data for those students, which counts as attrition. Choice A is incorrect. Students changing schools or dropping out of school is a common cause of attrition. Choice C is incorrect. Finally, for choice D, missing outcome data from incomplete student records is also considered attrition. Now, let's turn to the attrition thresholds established by the WWC. The thresholds identify combinations of overall and differential attrition that separate what the WWC defines as high and low attrition.